I would like to welcome you here tonight on behalf of the Bob Hawke Prime Ministerial Centre and the University of South Australia. Penny Arcade is a performance artist, author, actress, and documentary maker, a former superstar of Andy Warhol's factory. She is an enduring figure of the 1960s New York counterculture. Penny last toured Australia with her internationally acclaimed sex and censorship show, Bitch, Dyke, Fag Hag, Whore, which premiered in Australia as part of the 1994 Adelaide Festival. And I know myself and many of us here tonight remember that oh so well and still have fond memories. And she is currently performing her five-star multi-award-winning show, Longing Lasts Longer, as part of the Adelaide Fringe Festival. I actually saw this show a couple of weeks ago, and I have to say that my mind was turned upside down, inside out, and sideways. Hence why I asked Penny to deliver a lecture here with us at UniSA, so that the students, hopefully there are some in the room tonight, academics, I know there are some academics here tonight, and the general public will have the opportunity to experience this wonderful mind at work. So I would now like to warmly welcome the divine Penny Arcade. Thank you.
Thank you. And thank you to the Ghana people and the ancestors. I'm all about ancestors. I'm all about epigenetics. Have you heard of epigenetics? Yeah, of course, because you live in Australia and you have time to think. I had only recently heard about it because I've been going to my village in southern Italy, and unbeknownst to me, in 2006, I stumbled on this reality that I was unaware of this big drama, big scandal with my grandmother. I'm not going to go into the story because that's like an incredibly complex story. But everywhere, my grandmother died in 1965, and she migrated to America in 1949, the year before I was born, and she was brought there by my father, who, it was his mother-in-law, and my grandfather migrated in 1922, so they hadn't seen each other in 25 years, and there was a reason for that, but I never knew about any of it, and I don't think my mother even knew, because families have secrets. But let it suffice to say that when I decided to go and find this taverna that my grandfather's brother Mingo had, my cousin Mamina said, oh, they're all dead. And I said, well, I would just like to go and see this place. And in my southern Italian dialect, which of course almost everybody, every Italian in Adelaide speaks the same dialect as me, you can say to someone, per piacere fammi un servizio, which means please do me a service. So this is very medieval. They have to do it because you're asking them to do a service for you. So anyways, I asked Mamina this, and she brought me to this taverna, which had been knocked down from the 1983 earthquake, and this was 2006, and I saw a man standing in the road there to the taverna, and I went up to him and I said, because you have to say this, because if you look like me, you have to say, I'm not a gypsy from Naples. You have to get that out of the way right away, right? And I said to him, I said, did you know Mingo, which was the name of my grandfather's brother that I kept hearing about? And he said, Mingo? Mingo was my grandfather. And I said, oh, I said, well, he was my grandfather's brother. He said, Don Pepino? And my grandfather died in 1970, but, you know, in these cultures, nobody dies. They're still there. So at any rate, then I saw an old woman sitting under this vine, this trellis of grapevines. I said, "Who's that old lady over there?" He said, "That old lady is my mother." And my cousin, Mamina, standing there, and she goes, "Rockina vive," which of course means Rockina's alive. And I go down to her and I explain very quickly, "Io non sono una zingara di Napoli, I'm not a gypsy from Naples." And I started to tell her who I was, and she started crying. And she said, "I've waited for you to come for 70 years. Mingo told me that you would come, and I had to tell you everything about your grandmother." And then the next day, I ended up going to another cousin that I didn't know existed, and because to meet her mother, who was 90, Filomena. And Filomena was 5'10 and strode into the room, and I found this place on my own. I mean, it's a great story, and I'm not telling it to you, but I promise I will write it out, and I'll send it. I will send it to your site, and you can read the... I'll finally write the whole story, and then you can read it. You'll be mind blown. But at any rate, outstrode Filomena, 5'9", 90 years old, e lucida, lucid. And she came out like this. "Do you know about your grandmother? We did not agree." You know, like this drama that happened with my grandmother happened in 1923. So what I realized that I had a role in healing this situation because my grandfather was dead, my grandmother's dead, my mother's dead, my father's dead, Mingo's dead. And a short time after this, I was in New York, and I was with a friend of mine, Hillary, who's about 34, 35, one of the smartest people I know. And I started telling Hillary this story, and Hillary said, "Penny, it's epigenetics." I said, "Epigenetics?" She said, "Yes." She said, "Scientists are finding that we carry the trauma of our ancestors with us." So that's why I, you know, had to acknowledge the ancestors who are here. I love Aboriginal culture. I did a show that's never come to Australia, but it was actually written because of my having been here 20-odd years ago, 22 years ago. I did it in 1996. I was commissioned by the Wiener Festwochen, the Vienna Theater Festival, a very big theater festival. And I wrote a show called Sissy Sings the Blues that takes place in the Dreamtime. And the music, it was my fin de siècle opera. And the music was written, part of it was written by the great Richard Tognetti, who is, of course, from the Australian Chamber Orchestra. And it was, I juxtaposed my suicidal breakdown in 1995 with Elizabeth of Austria's suicidal breakdown in 1895. And I had Sissy was played by Paul Capsis. Yeah, and when the press, at the press release, at the press launch, the press asked me why I wasn't playing Sissy. And I said, "I don't have to play Sissy. I am Sissy." So that suicidal, I might as well, you know, not leave you to wonder. I had been bitten by a Lyme's tick, and they had put me on this horrible medicine, on this very, very, very strong antibiotics. And I guess I'm one of those people who, when you put me on really strong antibiotics, I go completely out of my mind. And it wasn't so much that I wanted to kill myself as I thought I was already dead. You know, which was like a very, you know, like I had a disturbed sleep cycle that went on for like 2 months, and it was a really horrible experience. But it taught me a lot, as all horrible experiences do teach. And there's a beautiful saying that people say sometimes, which is to try to think of something that it's being done for you instead of done to you. Now, I know that sounds very hippie-like, but when we reframe it, and there are awful things that happen in our lives, it's very helpful to sometimes consider to have a curiosity. And in my show, Longing Lasts Longer, I talk about the fact that I have always employed the same curiosity and the same enthusiasm to all the horrible things that have happened to me in my life, as well as to all of the beautiful, fun things. So what I thought about tonight when I had this great opportunity, and my life is so synchronistic, and I have to say this because as you get older, the way you know you're on the right track is when your life becomes more and more and more synchronistic, right? So do any of you have the experience of synchronicity in your lives? Do you have that sense like things keep happening? Yeah. So this is good. This is like fantastic. And I believe that synchronicity is tied into our authenticity, that when despite what the world says to us, when despite the that we're not fitting or conforming to the world's standards of success, of I don't know what else, success, everything's success these days. Even when we're not conforming, but we get these little messages that we're on the right track. So I thought that, first of all, we have the huge synchronicity of Bob Hawke, who happens to be a friend of mine, which I didn't know who Bob Hawke was when I first came to Australia. And I was telling this story to Jacinta, and I'll just briefly tell you. I was in Melbourne, and I was at the comedy club, and they had opened the comedy club for me. I was the first act in there. And they asked me if I would do a benefit for the women who were the victims of the Serbo-Yugoslavian horror. This is 1995, I think. And I had said yes, and they said, oh, there's a wonderful journalist writer coming named Blanche Del Puget, you'll love her. And I was like, oh, I'm so excited. I love to meet fabulous women. So I'm waiting, and all of a sudden, all these people start streaming out of every corner of this building. And they're just hanging. I'm like, why are these people here? And they're just standing like at attention and waiting. And then this man swept through with this gigantic head of white hair. And he was running, literally running towards me and threw his arms around me. And I said, who the fuck are you? And I pushed him and I went up to Blanche, who was 10 feet behind him, and hugged her. And then I turned around and I looked at him and I said, I don't know what you do, but with that head of hair, you could have your own TV show. And he started laughing. And then, of course, then I found out that he was not only the former prime minister, but the most charismatic prime minister that Australia ever had, and a politician when politics weren't as creepy as they are now, right? Where actually somebody could stand for something. You know, not to say that Bob, you know, didn't have his own interests. I'm not saying that. But I think that, you know, he is representative of a kind of political leader that we now long for, now that we're in an emergency, wishing it would go back to being a crisis. So when I found the synchronicity that I was at the Bob Hawke Center, I immediately started tweeting Bob. And I'm looking forward to seeing him and Blanche when I go to Sydney. And I'm so excited to be here, and I'm so happy to learn. I guess I had known that he was from South Australia, but South Australia is my favorite because everything good grows here to eat. That's very important. And because it's the first place that I came, and because, you know, you have to think, 22 years ago, Central Market, many more Italian food handlers were there. And everywhere I went, everybody spoke my dialect. And, you know, the non-assimilationist policy that existed in Australia allowed people to keep their language, whereas in America, we did not keep our, I mean, I still have my language, but my brothers and sisters don't, you know. So for me, Adelaide meant a lot. I called my mother up and I said, Ma, why didn't you migrate to Australia? And she said, Austria? Poor mommy. She didn't know that Australia existed. But I thought what would be in keeping with synchronicity and with the evening, and also because when often I speak at universities, I always try to find out what the people, usually it's like actors or artists, performers, and I try to make the lecture that I'm doing about what will interest them, because there's no point in just doing a cookie cutter talk, who cares, you know? So I thought maybe we could identify four things that are on people's minds, like what you're really thinking about. And I mean, not what you're thinking about here, but like what you're thinking about in here, because we all have a lot that we're grappling with, you know? And I think we're so much more similar than we are different. So they have some mics, so think about it for a second. And probably you don't have to think about it that hard, because, you know, when we are thinking about something a lot, it's kind of right there on the surface waiting for us. So do you know what I mean? Have I been clear? Perhaps I've not been clear. I'll give you an example. What am I thinking about a lot? I keep thinking about everything in its time. I'm 65, I'm gonna be 66. I keep going over my life and keep stumbling over things and thinking, oh, I could have done that differently, and oh, if I had done this, and oh, now I'm here, but no, I'm not ready to be here. I'm not ready to be at the end. I want to be, well, no, I'd like to go and redo like around 30 to 45. I know I could spend my time much better than I did. You see? So that's what's very much on my mind. Okay, so any thoughts out there in the world? One person here. I want to identify people first. We need four. Anybody else? One person back there. Wow, two. Okay, three. One more. Four. Yay, we did it. Okay, let's start at the front and work our way back.
Will the people of the world ever experience peace?
Will the people of the world ever experience peace? Okay, that's one thing. That's what's on your mind? Wow, you're altruistic.
I'm very concerned about the possibility of having nuclear waste in our state.
Yeah, me too.
And also of having BP drilling in the Great Australian Bight.
What?
The company BP is going to start drilling in the Great Australian Bight. They've had one knockback, but they told local people, we'll have two, but then the third time we'll get through.
True.
Has art in our city become a consumeristic product?
Has art become
a consumeristic product in Adelaide?
In Adelaide, everywhere. Yeah, we'll talk about that. Okay. And there was one more person here.
The soul of our city, how corporatization and development is ruining neighborhoods.
Say it again?
The soul of Adelaide.
The soul of Adelaide.
Yeah, recently, lots of development, which is just ruining our neighbourhoods.
Okay, wow, okay. Wow, you people don't have personal problems, do you? Well, first of all, I just jump into, like, the Adelaide thing because, you know, I talk about how much I love Adelaide and people are always like, you know, skeptical, you know, like I'm pandering to the audience. And this will be like in my show, like after I've talked in depth about Adelaide. You know, I'm not just going, I love Adelaide. I'm like talking about how the city has been architecturally molested. You know, how it's obvious that this was a pristine Victorian city. And the thing that's so interesting to me about Adelaide is that I say spiritually Adelaide sits in between a gigantic mountain of neoconservatism and bordering on fascism. And then on this side, another equally gigantic mountain that is filled with an extraordinary hopefulness, of really a progressive visionary humanity, like political humaneness. And so many things that have happened in Adelaide have happened because of this fight between these two energies. I walk around, you know, I haven't been here for 22 years, and I was kind of stunned by how much concrete had been poured in this city over 20 years. Like going over to the Rundle Mall, it was like, it was tiny 22 years ago. Now it could be anywhere, you know? But it could be anywhere the way everything is anywhere. If you go to Istanbul and you go to Taksim, it looks exactly like Rundle Mall. And if you go to Paris, it looks exactly like Rundle Mall. And it's this kind of sameness that is eating up the entire planet. And some of the stuff that I talk about in Longing Lasts Longer is about what the effect of gentrification, because gentrification affects neighborhoods and cities, but it also affects ideas. And there's a gentrification of the mind. And based on my ideas about the gentrification of ideas, Sarah Schulman, who is a great writer in New York, wrote a book called Gentrification of the Mind, where she took it much further. You know, like she wrote an entire book just on that subject. And, but what do we do about it? This is the issue. I mean, we are not, there is an apathy everywhere. I mean, everything's intellectualized. Where the problem is that when they tear down the authentic buildings, we lose the visual proof of an alternative. I mean, I have to say, and I must commend all of you, the fact that Starbucks was not allowed to take root here. I mean, it's the only place in the entire world. You realize there are Starbucks in Rome, okay, in Paris, littered with Starbucks. You can't even believe it. You're just like, why would anybody go to a Starbucks in Rome? Why? 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 Because somebody has convinced them that there's some kind of trendiness, you know, or something new to it. And one of the things that I talk about in Longing Lasts Longer is the difference between longing and nostalgia. Because a lot of times, anyone who would say anything about what is happening to, let's say, inner Adelaide, they're just going to tell you that you're being nostalgic. I mean, there is the other problem, which is there are just many, many, many more people on the planet than existed before. I mean, is it really possible that the little stone shack that I'm living in really costs $500,000? I mean, is that possible? Like, so like what? So like 20 years ago, you know, really poor people were living there? So are we to think that poor people used to live better than rich people? I think that might be true. So the question becomes, at the end of the day, what do we do? How do we affect? I mean, my neighborhood in New York has been just completely decimated. We have fought, we have tried. They're building, I mean, I can't believe that they're not building more towers here. You know, as soon as they could figure out how to lure people here, you know, it's like you're very lucky because people don't want to live in Adelaide. This is one thing that by the time the bubble really bursts, you will have been saved. But you go anywhere else, you go to London, you go to my neighborhood, downtown New York, anywhere in New York, there's nothing but cranes. And they are now having people invest in gentrification. So people are no longer buying an actual building, but they are investing in the building of these high towers, which of course they're all gonna lose their money, right? But nobody cares about that. So it's a very difficult situation. I don't know what more I can say about it, because I tried in my neighborhood, along with a lot of other people, to stop some incredible, I live on the Lower East Side of New York, and even people in New York didn't know where my neighborhood was. So I would say to people, well, there's Soho, there's NoHo, and I live in uh-oh. Because I lived in a slum. You couldn't get a cab, you couldn't get food delivered. I mean, all of these things that, you know, were, you know, kind of the New York experience did not exist in my neighborhood. And now it's become the trendiest neighborhood, and they are building on every block another tower, so the buildings are no taller than 5 stories, and they're building all of these 26-story buildings, and it's as if there is no city planning. This is the issue. So I don't know, it might work better here. If you went to city planning meetings that were open to the public, you probably could create some effect. You need a mic. Excuse me.
The state government has taken over the role of the city government in planning so that they and their mates can make lots of money out of development. So people are taking over from what the ordinary people want. It's the difference between government and governance. Government is by the people, for the people. Governance is telling people what they should do so you and your mates make money. That's the place we're in. Thank you.
Okay. So I think we understand that that Adelaide is being affected by statewide politics. So what can we do? I mean, I could suggest something, but it's not legal. So I'm not going to go there. So let's see. So she was asking about peace. I think that for most of us who are over 50, and there's a lot of people here over 50, I think that looking at the way the world is right now is a really frightening proposition. And we all really feel guilty, because we all feel really lucky, because we got to live the majority of our lives in a way that younger people will simply never have that experience. And, you know, I mean, 22 years ago when I did Bitch, Dyke, Fag, Hag, Whore here in Adelaide, I presented an idea, and that idea has not changed in all these years, and that idea is, I do not believe that we can change the world. But I do believe we can change the world around ourselves. And that is all I really have to say about it. I had an experience in London 3 years ago. I did 48 shows of Bitch, Dyke, Fag, Hag, Whore. I added 4 sentences. And the show, the London Times called it the most quotable show in London. And I was living in Islington, which is my preferred neighborhood to live in. I have friends who live there, and I always stay in that neighborhood. And it's North London. And it's a working class, kind of left-wing neighborhood, kind of like me. And it was a Saturday, and I was walking up the street, and there's many, many, many Muslim people living in that neighborhood. And there was a man with 8 or 9 children, like ranging from like 4 or 5 to like 13 or 14. And they were just all lined up, and he was grabbing people and proselytizing. And he had grabbed this woman, a black woman, who appeared to be like in her late 70s, and the woman was yelling, "But I love Jesus." And So, of course, me being me, I'm walking by and I just stopped and I said, what appears to be the problem? And the man was thrilled, you know, turned to me, and he said, there is only one God and it is Allah. And I said, you know, what is it with you? What is your problem? Why do you come to a country that allows you to practice your religion, and why can't you be live and let live? And he looked at me, and I realized he was training these children. So this man was not a Muslim, he was an Islamicist, which is not the same thing. And he turned to me and he said, everywhere belongs to Allah. And in that moment, I was slain in the spirit because I realized there was absolutely nothing I could say to this person. And the realization came over me that there was never, ever, ever going to be any solution. Because as long as that's where it rests, then we're talking about we're going backwards in history. You know, we're going back to the Crusades. We're going back to a time, you know, when the Moors were clashing with the Christians. And I particularly hate George Bush for being the person who actually created this jihadist mentality, because he, in his speeches, is the person who first used the words crusades and first used the words jihad. So I don't know where we're going to go with it. I think, you know, once again, I'm talking about this in Longing Lasts Longer, where I'm talking about the fact that all we ever hear about now is technology. And, you know, a lot of people, younger people, think that people my age are like Luddites and that, like, we're anti-technology or we don't know anything about technology, which is completely wrong, because actually it's my generation, people who were born somewhere, you know, between 1943 and 1963, who were the first people who were online. I've been online since 1992. You know, all of us use computers. Like, we're very busy. We're the people who are, you know, makes me mad, you know, like this idea that, you know, that people who are over 50 are like the lame ones, you know, and we're not. You know, we're the ones who rock and roll meant something to us, that the songs actually meant something. That's why the soundtrack in my show and in all my shows, the soundtrack is very, very important. Why? Because I am part of a generation that we believed the music. The music was supporting our values and pushed us forward in our understanding of what we were thinking about. But the thing is that I'm somebody who's desperately trying to claw my way back into the 20th century. Because it doesn't look good. The 21st century, I'm sorry, doesn't look good. People are very, very isolated. People are very alienated. People are, you know, zillions of people are on computers all alone. They don't have real friends. You know, they're involved, you know, with the Kardashians. You know, they're involved with some kind of this kind of culture that's being broadcast to us, which I talk about which I talk about in Strangely Longing Lasts Longer. How many of you have seen my show? Okay, so quite a few of you have seen it. So you know what I'm talking about. When I say this over and over, we're talking about the integrated spectacle, right? This was created, this idea was created as an explanation by Guy Debord in 1968. He wrote a book called Society of the Spectacle. And in that book, he talked about how the government, the financial institutions, and technology had merged with media and marketing to create an illusion of reality. So people measure their lives against an illusion that is out there, and they are desperate. There's so much desperation. My Facebook page is, I keep it open. It's a kind of it's somewhere between a diary and a magazine. You know, I promote a lot of other artists on it, and I also put a lot of ideas there because, you know, I'm desperately trying to figure out how do I stay alive, really alive, now, you know? And I think that that's the thing that's, I got my hair stuck in this earring. Oh, no, it's okay. Jacinta, ready to help. I bought these earrings in a little op shop in Wollonga. Oh my God, I love it down there, the beach. You people are so lucky. But I'm not gonna tell them in the rest of the country, no. But at any rate, so there is, it has to be faced that there is a tremendous alienation. Now, you're here, that means you're thinking, people, right? And we know from contemporary neuroscience that thinking is hard. That's why no one does it. A few years ago, I took all these courses in coaching because I was divorced and my financial status changed overnight, as it does for women when they become divorced. And I was like, well, maybe I'll be a therapist, you know? So I thought, well, I should be a therapist. And then I found out, like, how long you have to study for that. And then... I'll be a social worker, and then I can do, like, therapy. And then I found out you had to do, like, not only 5 years of university, but then you had to do 2 years of statistics. And the shrink that I was seeing at the time said, you should get into coaching. You're a natural. And I was like, okay, coaching. So I went to New York University, and I took these classes, which... Of course, with the world that we live in is so cheesy that in America, and I'm sure here in Australia as well, you can take classes for 2 weeks and become a life coach. Nobody thinks there's anything strange about that. And it's all about the quick buck. People who are selling the courses. So we live in a world where there is no scholarship. So I took 4 years to take these courses that other people were completing basically in about a month. And what I loved most about it was there was a great focus on contemporary neuroscience. So as we were speaking earlier of epigenetics, there is also this reality about what you have to do in order to think a new thought. What you have to do in order to actually do something new in your life. And when I learned that in order to think a new thought, we have to actually make a new groove, a physical groove in our brain that is deeper than the groove of the thought or the opinion that we already hold, or the groove of the habit that we already hold. And then suddenly, because we're all so hard on ourselves, suddenly if you know that, you can actually take more time towards changing certain circumstances, which begin with changing your idea about those circumstances. Okay, now, wait a minute. There was peace. There was Adelaide. There was art. Oh, yeah, art in Adelaide. Well, it's interesting, of course, because you people here in Adelaide are exposed to so much more art and so much more theater and so much more literature than other people. And also, you have time here. There is time in Adelaide. And if I... See... I'm not big on artists, okay? Right? Healthy, balanced people do not usually become artists, okay? Let's be honest, okay? I believe that one has a fervent artistic milieu where there is one-third artists with two-thirds people living an artistic life. Now, it is much more difficult to live an artistic life than it is to actually be an artist, and very, very few artists live an artistic life. Now, what do I mean by that? I mean people for whom literature, poetry, photography, films, music, theater are really important. And I think that here in Adelaide, and this has built over decades and decades, that there is an orientation, even for people who might come from an economic strata or a social strata that was not interested in art. For instance, look, I come from a family where nobody has ever read a book, okay? No, I have two brothers and one sister. Only one of them has ever seen me perform, okay? It's not because they don't like me, okay? It's not part of their culture. They don't go to the theater, so why should they come and see me in the theater? They like to go to casinos. They like to go on cruises. They like to go to restaurants. They don't go to the theater. So what are we talking about here? We're talking about orientation. So if someone had the luck to be born in Adelaide, unless you were incredibly thick, you would know that there was theater, because you'd know there was the Adelaide Festival, you'd know there was the Fringe, and you might feel, even if you were not of the classes that usually partake of the arts, you might feel that you had a right to go and participate in those things. The fact that you have Writers Week, which I myself enjoyed this week, and just was completely gobsmacked over the fact that it's free. That it's free. Free! And you're listening to world-class people. Yeah, they want to sell books, understood, but there are libraries. You can go and sit and listen. I listened to Mr. Winchester talk about the Pacific, and it was really fascinating. And I can't remember the other person I listened to. I've forgotten his name right now, but that's okay. But the point is to be sitting under those leafy trees with among people of all ages enjoying this intellectual pursuit, having new ideas, being with people in a calm, quiet environment that was really focused on something that was enlivening of the spirit. That's a very rare thing to have that. So I believe that here in Adelaide, you have an unusual situation, and it's the same as Edinburgh. And I love Edinburgh, and I love to be there, and it has the same feeling. They have also a Writers' Week attached to their fringe, and I have to say that Edinburgh, except for the horrible weather, you know, is a lot like Adelaide, except they have the just horrible weather, which you don't have to have. So as far as what's going on in the arts right now, I will say this. We are living in this culture of emerging arts. So have all of you heard of emerging arts? More or less sort of nod or do something, yeah, okay. So what's happened is emerging arts started in 1985, around 1985, and it was in the wake of Ronald Reagan and the whole Christian right, where they were not gonna fund art that talked about sex or talked about any kind of un-Christian sexualities or orientations. And it became known to people in the arts that money for the arts was going to go towards education. So what basically started to happen was it created this kind of hothouse environment where young people were encouraged to go and study art and then were rewarded with money, with grants. So Penny Arcade axiom number one is we live in a culture that is obsessed with potential and is dismissive of accomplishment. So hand in hand, you know, with the ageism that has just been building since the 80s. Now, people will say to me, but Penny, you're from the generation that said don't trust anybody over 30. And I say, yes, I am. But I knew that the people who were saying that were over 30. Abby Hoffman, Rubin, all those guys, they were all over 30, you know, when they were saying that. But, you know, now I don't trust anybody under 50. Because I find that empathy is being bred out of people. Younger people are having empathy bred out of them, and it's not all younger people. And it all depends on whether or not you have some kind of consciousness about where you are in the society. What do I mean by that? I mean that we are all tethered to the values of the generation that we come up in. Nobody can escape that. But you have to be able to make a decision whether you agree with those values or not. Like, some people think that there are young people. I mean, there was a girl who reviewed me here on a blog called Rip It Up blog. She reviewed me and she said, oh, Penny Arcade was such a bore. Yeah, she said, Penny Arcade was such a bore. That I can believe. She goes, she was just throwing around cliches left and right, like cultural amnesia and mediocrity is the new black. So I wrote her, and I said, listen, speaking of those cliches, is it still a cliche if I'm the person who wrote it? So there are people in every generation. We can't say that, like, one generation is different than another, but young people are really under a tremendous strain, you know, that people my age were not, because nobody cared what I thought till I was in my late 40s. I wasn't expected to have an overview, and people who are in their early 20s are expected to be experts. The culture tells them that they're supposed to be an expert. And I have a friend who's my age, and her son is about 24, and we were having dinner together, and he started kind of berating his mother. And his mother was talking about the fact that his name is Cody. He's a really very, very nice young guy, but he always complains about his girlfriends because while they're physically extremely beautiful, they never measure up intellectually. So Dee was trying to say to him, well, look, stop choosing girls, you know, on the fact that they have to be like, you know, 5'9" and weigh 124 pounds and, you know, be extremely beautiful, and try to go for somebody with a personality. And he was complaining, and like they were sparring. And he looked at me, and I said to him, I said, Cody, I'm sorry if in the face of our lived experience, your theory seems a little bit light. So what's happened in the arts, and, you know, I'm not that familiar with what's going on in Australia the way I'm familiar with what's going on in the UK and in Germany and in the United States and in Europe in general. But we have this emerging arts, and what has happened is there are generations and generations of people who are getting money thrown at them, which is basically a reward for getting an MFA. So people are getting masters of fine arts in performance, in theater, where people like me, who are highly achieved artists, because there is no work for highly achieved artists in America or in Europe. You know, in Europe it's a little bit better, but they're now starting to follow an American ideal, you know, to not fund arts. And, you know, there's millions and millions of festivals in Europe. In America, we have almost nothing. In America, we very rarely see artists from other countries because it is provincial there, you know? And yeah, I'm telling the truth. It is provincial. I know that when my friend Virginia Hiram, who used to run the studio theater at Sydney Opera House, she was coming to New York and everybody wanted to take meetings with her. She was getting to meet with, you know, the highest levels of performing arts spaces. But not one of those performing arts spaces wanted to bring Australian artists to America. But they all wanted the artists that they were pushing to perform at Sydney Opera House. So I think that, you know, one has to tell the truth about these kinds of things. So one of the elements that is going on now is that this ageism is perpetrated by older people. People who are afraid not to be cool. Right? People who have this whole idea that young people are the people who have the ideas. And all of us know, who were once young, that we never had any ideas when we were young. We were looking for an idea. You spend your 20s, your 30s, looking for an idea. You would love to have an, oh my God, what would you give for an original idea? So I say to like young people now, I'm like, you know what? I'm the original youth generation, 60s, right? 1966, Diana Vreeland in Vogue said it. She said, it's the year of the youth quake. Anybody who's anybody is a teenager. So when they said that we were the coolest people, we didn't believe them. We thought, you know, I think somebody with a record collection and somebody who's traveled, maybe somebody who's in their 40s, somebody who actually, like, has weed and, you know what I mean? Like, somebody who has lived, I think they're cooler than me. We didn't buy into it. But this is all part of the consumerism of identity. So being an artist is no longer a kind of work that you do. Now being an artist is an identity. And this is all part and parcel with the way the world is moving. And what do we do about it? What can we do about it? We really can't do very much because it is what is happening now. The ageism, like all that ageism, I keep telling people, you know, people who are treating me in an ageist way, who are in their 20s and 30s, I'm like, this is going to come and bite you on the ass way earlier than it bit me on the ass. So it's, you know, it's biting me on the ass. I'm 65. But people in their 20s are being made socially redundant when they're 40. That's what I'm hearing in the world now. People coming to me who are 41, 42 years old, who are working on arts projects with people in their early 20s, and the early 20-year-olds are shunning them as being too old. So this is an ongoing problem, and as long as in America, for instance, every single art space has a mission statement that is about emerging arts. We must support young artists. So for 1,000 years, there were young artists who became old artists, but no, now they have to be in this hothouse environment. Well, it can't be. It can't be, because you have to be willing to be bad for 20 years in order to be great. No matter what you do. You're going to be better at something 20 years later, whether you're a shoemaker or whether you're an artist. Okay, now what didn't I talk about? Huh? Oh my God, listen, I was so shocked. Because, you know, I walk around all day long talking about how incredible South Australia is, how everything good to eat grows here. And then I read the newspaper about how you're going to take, you know, all of the nuclear trash of the world for $438 billion. And I was just devastated. And yet, it was brought to my attention that that nuclear waste has to go somewhere. Well, that's the question, like, where is it? I can tell you this. In America, the way we dealt with it was they put it in large barrels, and they sunk it into the sea in off the coast of Massachusetts, which is one of our greatest fishing areas. That was a really good idea, right? So someone was telling me here, when I asked, because I've been asking a lot about it, and they said, well, it's going to be put way, like, thousands of miles away where there's no earthquakes and you have all this empty land. But I think that when we keep, you know, calling on the Ghana people and calling on the culture that is rooted here, that tampering with the earth is always a bad idea. And yet, I have no idea how else this problem can be solved. Like, it's got to go somewhere. And obviously, all the other countries have decided that Australia is desperate for money, and it has a vast emptiness where, you know, garbage could be placed and, you know, conveniently not thought about again. Is there going to be a referendum? Do you think, would there be a referendum? Would this be a no, it won't be a decision of the people. Yeah, it's a frightening prospect, and it's a greater, even worse prospect, because it's not about us. It's not about us. You know, when I go and I talk and I speak at universities, and I'm always annoying people, younger people especially get frequently annoyed by me, some of them. Well, they're the only ones who are there, so of course they're going to be annoyed by me. And I'll say to them, yeah, I know you hate me, but you know what? In 30 years, I'm going to be dead, and you're not going to have any water to drink. So I think that this is what we're really talking about, is the legacy that's being left. But have you noticed the thing with children? Like, over the past 10 or 15 years, I think I started noticing it about 10 or 12 years ago, that babies are so different than they were when I was 20. Remember babies, newborn babies? They used to have little tight eyes, like little mice, and they just were like that till they were like 7 months old, and then they had a personality. And they're not like that now. Now newborns are like totally awake. Do you know what I'm saying? I know you all know what I mean. They're like completely alive and awake and engaged. Why? Because they know that they have to be warriors, right? So I don't know where it's going, but most of us are not going to be here when all of the really bad stuff happens. But because I don't believe you go anywhere when you die, we'll probably still, like, be around, only nobody will see us and we won't be able to say much. Yep. So I want to open it up to questions. We're going to do, like, 15 minutes if anybody has any questions for me.
Wisdom in Indian culture, for example, I always experience the respect for the elderly, and they sit in that wisdom beautifully. Our wisdom seems to be not perhaps taken advantage of, and that was just sitting around what you were saying of not listening to anyone who's, you know, who's under 50.
Yeah, well, I think that, you know, this is something that we have to own. You know, I think one of the things that's really exciting in my show is because I'm up there and no 25-year-old can outrock me. It's not possible, okay? And so we have this incredible sound score. The show is 75 minutes with 100 sound cues of music from the past 50 years. And it's not gratuitous. The music is there to drive the message of what's underneath both the comedy and the cultural critique that I'm saying. And one of the things that I keep saying is, that's right, it's my generation that is the generation that speaks like this. This is sex, drugs, and rock and roll. You know, I'm not recommending that everybody go out and, you know, try sex, drugs, and rock and roll who are in their 20s and 30s now, because it's just not the same. We used to have sex with people like, if you were in the room with somebody, you probably would have sex with them. It was how we mediated knowing ourselves and knowing other people. And it's the same thing with drugs. I don't recommend anybody to take LSD because you can't get good LSD. You know? But there is something to be said that this thing that I started the evening with about talking about the fact to each stage of life. Look, if you look in Vogue or Bazaar magazine, I'm a big magazine reader, I love fashion magazines, there's a section called like something like beautiful at any age or whatever, and there's four pages. So page one has 20 and 30, and then the next page has 40 and 50, and then the next page has 50 and 60, and then the next page has 70. So, you know, I've been reading these magazines since I was 17. Last year, I'm like, oh my God, I only have two more sections. You know? It's an adventure. Look, life is very short. Absolutely nothing happens between 20 and 27, and then you're old. 27 to 39 drags on like summer. When you're 9 years old, it's never over, and nothing happens. 39 to 50 lasts 3 weeks, and everything happens. 50 to 60 lasts 4 days, and even more happens. But if you have a rigorous inquiry into your own life, and that cannot start when you're 50. It's got to start earlier. Or it could start right now, maybe. I don't know. I don't want to limit anything. But if you have a rigorous inquiry into your own life, when you're 60, you get to start all over again, like you're 20, only this time raised by you. You're your own mother. You're your own father. And that's the thing that we have to do, rather than looking at the society, because the society is only going to send you one message, and which is, you're done, you know? And also, that's the message of menopause, you know? It's a biological message. You're done. I remember when I met Phoolan Devi. Do you know who Phoolan Devi is? Phoolan Devi, the famous Indian bandit queen. Phoolan Devi. I first heard about her in Australia when they made that movie about her. Then I was in Delhi, and this was in 1995, and I decided to go and find her. And I did find her. Yeah. And she was in total shock about me. Because I was like telling her, like, you know, you can do anything you want. I was like, you know, you need to learn to speak English. And she was like, I can't learn to speak English. And I, because she wanted to, you know, be, she was in Parliament. I said, well, you need to be able to speak. If you want to, like, really have an influence, you have to be able to speak to people. She goes, I can't do that. I said, you can't do that. I said, you went and you killed 22 men. I said, you went to this festival of Mata Durga and you put a necklace that weighed 5 kos of gold on the goddess's neck and told the police you were going to be there and you got away. What do you mean? If you can do that, you can learn to speak English. And then she said to me, she wanted to know how old I was. And at the time, she was 31 and I was 45. And she was like, she goes, I can't. She goes, I'm too old. I said, really? How old are you? She said, I'm 31. Well, in India, a grandmother is in her 20s. You can be a great grandmother in your 30s. So, you know, it's all relative, but what I'm saying here is that we have to own it. You can't be looking for approval. You can't even be looking for directions from the world. The world is in a terrible situation. Each of us is a sentient being. Each of us has ideas that are only coming, we have thoughts that are only coming in through us. And we have to be the ones who are brave enough, if not for others, at least for ourselves, to withstand this pain of thinking and to think our way through and to decide. I mean, I think about it all the time. I'm like, okay, I'm going to be 66. That means I have 20 years, 66 to 76, 76 to 86. I have seen people, 76 to 86, they start losing mobility. I'm probably not going to be traveling the way I do, you know, sleeping in airports, doing all, like, going and staying in hostels. I spell that H-O-S-T-I-L-E. When some of those 22-year-old girls see me in the hostel, like, what are you doing here? Well, I've been going to hostels since I was 17, bitch. But the point being is that when you realize that, and I knew I wanted to talk about this because I spent a week, I've just been hanging out with Marianne Faithfull a lot, and she's remarkable. She won't be touring to Australia because she's physically not able to. But one of the things that she's 5 years older than me, and one of the things that I've been talking to her about, I also had spoken a great deal with the great Judith Molina of the Living Theater, who died last year at the age of 87. And Judith and I talked a great deal about this in the last 2 or 3 years of her life, and that is that as we get into our 60s, and really it starts in your 50s, but as you get into your 60s, this last stage of life is about completing our character. And this is a very important thing because people think, oh, well, I've already fucked up enough. You know, like, really, I can't fix anything. I made so many mistakes. There were so many things I should have done. And we all live with a great deal of regret. And people will say to me, oh, why do you have regret? I'm like, well, you know, anybody who's over 12 has regret. You know, when you realize you're never going to be a ballerina, you know, when you realize you're never going to be a baseball player. But regret, many of these emotions are there to point us in directions, right? So if you feel a certain regret, you must investigate that. What Quentin Crisp used to call and used to tell me all the time, Miss Arcade, we must take the journey within. which is a not altogether pleasant journey. But at any point where you are, I think it was Gertrude Stein said, we're always the same age inside. So it's up to you. What are the next 20, 30, 40 years of your life going to look like? I remember when I was wasting time in my 20s, 30s, and 40s. I would be doing something and I would say to myself, I would notice and I'd say, you're wasting time right now. I wasted time. I'm not wasting any now. Thank you so much.